Hi, my name is Zoran Horvat. Today we are going to play a game. You will be a candidate and I will interview you for a job. I will ask you three technical questions on .NET and C#. I will also give you the answers, but before the answers, you will be able to stop the video and try to answer the questions on your own. All right, let's get to the questions. Question number one. There is a function which receives as an argument a func delegate and makes a call to it. Your task is to invoke this function do in as many different ways as you can. Essentially, I want to see you assigning to a func delegate in many different ways. Next question. There is a struct. And I will try to do a couple of things that we normally do with classes, and none of those will work with a struct. I want to declare a virtual function on it. The compiler wouldn't let me do that. I want to inherit a new struct from it. No can do. And the last attempt, if I got an instance of this struct, I wanted to lock on it to use it as a synchronization object. Well, again, compiler wouldn't let me do that. So the question for you is, why none of these attempts works in C#? Third question. There is just a class, a common class, with a function that receives an integer on it. Then there comes the derived class, with an overload, a function with the same name, but which receives a double argument. Now, if we had a proper integer variable, and made a call on the base instance to the function f, passing that variable, and then the derived instance making a call to the same function f, passing the same integer x, what would be the output of this code? In other words, which exact functions will this code invoke? So these are the three questions for you. Try to give a proper technical answer, but let me give you out a secret. I'm not looking for just correct answers. Actually, you can make a mistake. I don't care about that. What I'm looking for is your ability to connect the backing knowledge, the knowledge of the tools and the language, and tail the answer to these questions. So I want to see your thinking process. And on top of that, I expect you to know your tools, to know .NET and to know C#. Take your time. Produce your own answers, and then resume the video and watch my answers to my questions. All right, there we are, the answers section. The answer to the first question, what was it? Oh, calling the function which receives a func delegate. If you come up with, say, three ways to invoke a function that receives a func delegate, I wouldn't be satisfied, because that shows inability to combine different kinds of syntax. In C#, all the functions will eventually be methods on some class, either the class that was generated or the function, the method that was generated by the compiler, or you made it. But in syntax, that way is not always visible. What if we already had a func delegate? Pass it to the function. So the one way to invoke this function is just to pass a func delegate to it. I have used a lambda to construct this delegate, so why not use a lambda? This is the second way to invoke the function. What if we had a class, and that class had a static method defined with the same signature as that func delegate? Or maybe an instance level function, again with the same signature. We can use the method group to identify the static method on that class and pass it in place of the func delegate, since the method's signature is the same as that of the func delegate, compiler will not complain. Or if we had an instance of this class, we could poke its instance level method, again use the method group and pass it in place of the func delegate. What if we had a delegate, a strongly typed delegate type in our type system, then we could have an instance of that delegate, just pass that instance, but that doesn't work. Strongly typed delegates and func delegates are not assignable to each other, but there is the way out. pass the strongly typed delegates invoke method group instead. That will work. This is the way number 5. There are more. What if we had a function, a method, anything? In there can be a local function as well. And that local function is a perfect fit for a func delegate, so we can just pass it in. Once we invoke this function, the call to the do method with appropriate delegate will be made. These are 6 methods to invoke a function which receives a func delegate. You can use a reflection to isolate a static method or an instance level method from an object. You can apply more esoteric methods to call this function. For example, you can emit an intermediate language code for a class and a method on it, and that method would have exactly the same signature as the one the do method is expecting. So why not doing that? There are at least a couple of other ways to accomplish this same task, and I will leave that to you. So I did it. I have invoked this method in at least 6 substantially different ways. I hope you liked this answer. If you did, please like the video. That will help me spread the word about this channel. Thank you. Otherwise, let's move on to the second question. The question about structs. Well, that is a mystery. Why doesn't struct support any of these 3 attempts? No virtual methods, no inheritance, no locking. How come? The answer is in the things the struct does not have. And to find them, we might start from a class, because the class has all these 3. What does the class have? When you instantiate a class, there will be an object in memory. And what will that object have? It will have 2 mandatory fields that you don't see. One is the sync table entry. It is an integer that is indexing into a sync table where synchronization objects are held and maintained by the runtime. Initially, every object will have 0 here, which indicates nothing. There's no sync object or anything else associated with this instance right away. But once you do request a lock, or as you will see, a gethash code, this entry will be populated with an actual index of a newly allocated element in that table. Then there comes the type handle, a proper reference to the method table associated with the type of this object. So all objects of class C will point to the same method table because they do have the same list of methods. They are objects of the same class. And only after all this will come the fields you declared in the class C. If you had an instance of this class C, and you called gethashCode, and you didn't override the gethashCode method in your class, what will happen? The runtime will allocate 1 entry in the sync table, put its index back into this object, and generate a hash code and store it there for you, and return that value from the gethashCode call. If you call gethashCode again, then the runtime will notice that there is a sync table entry in this object, go over there, get the hash code, and return it again. So that is why, this could be another interview question, that is why gethashCode is returning the same value from the same object if you call it multiple times and you didn't implement your own gethashCode on that class. If we wanted to lock, again the sync table entry is used or initialized if not initialized before, and there will be a monitor object there that will be used in the synchronization context. So the lock statement in C# is using this field every single object has to obtain a monitor object which you can use in synchronization of threads. Inheritance. What if we had a class D deriving from C? That object would have all these things inside of it. Its own sync table entry, its own type handle, this time pointing to the method table of the class D, which is different from the class C. It is not the same class. Then there will come the fields inherited from the base class C, and only after that the additional fields declared by this class D. It's important if you had another instance, this time of class D, assigned to a reference to the base type. You can do that in C#, but if you invoked get type on that first instance, C, it will return one type object, and if you made a call to get type on the second instance, D, even though it is assigned to the C reference, it will return a different type object. The bad news is that structs have none of these. These two mandatory entries in an object, in a class object, do not exist in a struct object. Lock, you cannot lock on a struct because it doesn't have a sync table entry where the monitor object is located. Runtime has no way to obtain a synchronization object for a struct instance, and therefore the lock statement is not allowed on structs. Structs have no type handle that leads to the method table, therefore it's not possible to resolve virtual methods on a struct. Virtual methods are not possible on a struct. The last point, inheritance. Type handle in every class object leads to the type descriptor, which knows the list of methods, list of fields and everything on an object so that you can resolve them at runtime via reflection, for example. Again, the struct does not have a type handle and none of those information is available to the struct, therefore it's not possible to inherit from a struct. That is the full technical explanation why these three elements do not work on structs, why compiler doesn't allow them. If you want to learn more about this topic, I have the entire playlist with 4 videos about virtual methods, inheritance, what runtime is doing to construct objects when you instantiate them via the new operator, everything. If you want to learn that, watch the playlist with those videos. You can also find the link to that list in the description of this video. All right. Let's move to the question number 3. The answer to this question about calling overloaded methods on base and derived class. It is a trick question. When a call is made on the base instance, that is easy. There's only one function, the one receiving integer, and that function will be resolved. All right. But the second question is a tricky one because we have 2 candidates. And compiler must choose one of them. One requires a conversion, which is possible, integer to double is possible. The other does not require conversion, but it comes from a different class, from the base class. So which one of these two has precedence in C#? Again, it is a trick question, and it needs you to understand how the classes are defined in C#. Contrary to Java, in C#, a class is defined as a component which attempts to be self-sufficient whenever possible. So the compiler is first looking at the class itself and attempts to resolve a symbol that is requested. Compiler finds f of double and calls it. It doesn't even look into the base class in C#. And so the correct answer to this question is that in this second line, the derived f of double will be invoked, even though the argument was an int variable. The answer in Java would be different. There, the compiler would flatten the hierarchy, find 2 methods, one receiving int, the other receiving double, and choose one receiving int from the base class. It doesn't matter there. In C++, the answer is the same as in C#, but look here, I don't know why. So, if you happen to have a link to a text that explains this in C++, please send it over to me, write it down in the comments. I would really like to learn the answer to my own question. Well, all right. This is the full technical answer in C#. If you want to learn more, there are plenty of videos on this YouTube channel, so watch them. There's a lot of videos explaining how C# and .NET work, how they can be used in object-oriented and functional design. Watch those videos and learn. I hope you liked these questions and answers. Please like this video. I will appreciate it. Thank you. And Write your own questions in the comments. Ask me questions. Let's see. Maybe I can make another video with the questions and answers that are bothering you. Also, if you want to really, really learn programming, there are paid videos I made. There are plenty of videos I have published at Pluralsight, Udemy, Udemy for Business. Go there, follow me, and watch my video courses there. Thank you for watching and see you in the next video.